What happens in the Arctic doesn't really stay in the Arctic. It does impact the rest of us. And I think that's a lot of what scientists are trying to do, is just better unravel all of these teleconnections between various components in our climate system. We've always known that if we started seeing warming happening in the Arctic, you could generate this positive feedback loop whereby warmer temperatures will melt more snow and more ice, which then allows the water underneath the ice, for example, in the ocean or underneath the land, that is a lower reflectivity, so it actually absorbs more of the sun's energy. And then that can then melt more snow and ice, and you get this positive feedback loop. And it's also one of the reasons why the Arctic is warming 3 times faster than the rest of the planet at the moment. We know that the frozen ground contains at least twice as much carbon than what's in the atmosphere today. And so by warming up the Arctic, you start thawing also the frozen ground areas. And as that ground thaws, there's all these little microbes that start to become active, and they start to release carbon as well. And so there's another sort of amplifying feedback that if you start releasing more carbon that's been trapped and stored in the frozen ground, you're going to also amplify the warming and then, of course, thaw more permafrost. It's going to cause the planet to warm faster by losing the snow and ice. So that's, of course, one consequence. The second consequence, of course, is that you have massive ice sheet in the Arctic. You got the Greenland ice sheet. And if you were to melt the entire ice sheet, that contains about 7 meters of global sea level rise. Another impact, of course, is that the temperature difference between the equator and the poles drives a lot of our large-scale atmospheric weather and ocean circulation patterns. So the strength of the difference between, you know, if you have a really cold Arctic and a warm equator, you get this, you know, pretty strong jet stream, for example, that brings the weather around the planet. You can't say that one in particular event is a direct result of the loss of Arctic sea ice, for example, but they are connected. And I think that, you know, it's challenging for people at lower latitudes to fully appreciate these connections. And I think part of it has also been maybe the way media reports on extremes, because extremes get a lot of attention. I think it's really the long-term trends that people should be concerned about. At the moment, we have about 40 some years of satellite observation. So we usually talk about that as our climate record. And that's definitely showing statistically significant trends in many different variables, depending on what you want to look at. If you want to look at air temperature, or you want to look at Greenland melting, or you want to look at sea ice loss, those trends are real.